to meditate on every word, and then the sentence, and then the sentence that's tied to that sentence, and then the whole phrase. And so it's not just the dawn, it's the symbol
yes,
dawn.
Yes, yes.
And absolutely. That's where we are now. Canto 1, Book 1, the Book of Beginnings. Canto 1, the symbol dawn.
And where do things begin? You see this wonderful line. It was the hour before the gods awake. Across the path of the divine event, the huge foreboding mind of night alone in her unlit temple of eternity. What a wonderful beginning this is. Night itself is a preparation. She is lying in the temple of eternity. What is this temple of eternity? The cosmos is this temple. How we limit God to a small space of time. How liberating this is. You know, like before the prayer, it reminds me of, it happens in temples, that before people can come and open, the temple is open for all, this person who goes and sweeps the floors. Here also we do it at the samadhi.
Yes.
What does night do? She comes to do that. She removes all that dross, everything. And then when everything has been done, she waits. Waits for whom? For the light to come.
Yes.
In an unlit temple of eternity.
Yes.
What is that divine event? Of course, at three levels we can see it. The story of Satyavan and Savitri is a divine event. It's not just a everyday life story. After all, people die every day, but nobody comes back from the land of death. So it is an event of capital importance, because if it can happen in one life, it can happen in another life. The possibility is born.
Yes.
Creation is a divine event.
Yes.
It's not a accident superimposed upon time.
And the birth of Savitri is
is a divine event. And most importantly, every day there is a divine event that takes place. The conquest of light over darkness.
Yes.
This is the divine event. But night sits on the way. It is the antagonist of the play. It only ends up, as we will see later, it only makes the process more complete.
Yes.
So that's how it starts.
And a foreboding mind.
Foreboding mind of night. There is in it, this word foreboding, of course, is normally used for people, when they are anxious or they are brooding over something. Foreboding, normally used, something that is going to happen.
Right. But usually negative.
Usually negative.
A warning.
A warning. Now, the beauty is seen from one point of view. For the night, it is, of course, going to die. It's like for the ego, death of the ego is something which people are afraid of. That's why people are afraid of surrender, that's how the mother says.
Yes.
So for it, there is a sense of foreboding. It knows, my days, my moments are numbered. And yet it waits. It has done its job. Look, simultaneously there are so many layers. Why? Because she has hidden many things, inner folds. And she is waiting that, look, I have done my work. Now you have to come and take it. Like much later he would say, and the asuras wept with joy for the end that was close.
Right.
So you see, it's very interesting that, darkness had its own role. And now it waits to deliver these things to the light. But in the process, it is going to die. Its existence is going to be annihilated.
And it is on the marge of silence.
Marge of silence. It's a whole state of hush.
Yeah.
There is not yet either the workings of the gods, because they are not awake,
right.
nor the stir of creation and the created things. So it's on that, it's waiting, expectant. It is hiding things in its own fold, like the womb holding the baby inside before the labor pains have begun. So it is on the silence march. But of course, every line is a wonder. But I am just, you know, these lines. Look at this, turned from the insoluble mystery of birth. A power of fallen, boundless self awake between the first and the last nothingness.
Nothingness.
That's why it is called as the shadow. The first nothingness is the state of supreme existence, indefinable. Sometimes you will see the same word used for both, inane. Inane is a word Shirvinda used for both. Beyond reason, beyond thought, beyond senses, you cannot grasp it. None of our garbs hold any meaning there. That's why when the description of unknowable, pursuit of the unknowable, Shirvinda says, it's like a high negation, a zero, the eternal no. It's something which, like a zero sign of the Supreme.
Yeah.
You cannot say what it is. It is a nothingness.
And yet it is the zero carrier of the all.
All. And the same shadow in the inconscient. Yeah. Inconscient is its shadow.
Yes.
So it is also a state of zero because nothing has really been born out of it. It also hides everything.
But it's there.
It's there. The Supreme Himself is there.
Yes.
When darkness was covered and engulfed with darkness, He was seated within it, immense and alone. And that's why he says, recalling the tenebrous womb from which it came, turned from the insoluble mystery of birth and the tardy process of mortality, and longed to reach its end in vacant nought. The past efforts. At one place, mother says, why matter doesn't believe in grace? Why these cells don't believe in grace? Because they have evolved through pain and suffering, and every time they are confronted with the enigma of the night, death. So they don't believe it can happen. And it's such a long process, tardy process. And so it has a tendency to go back into vacant nought, whether through death or through escape. These are the two ways you can get out from
longing
the...
Longing to reach its end. Longing.
Longing. Insoluble mystery of birth.
Yeah.
You know, this is the bigger mystery than death.
Cannot be solved.
Yes. I mean, there is a purpose in it, but to the consciousness in our present frame, it looks like an insoluble mystery. Why should the Supreme become this?
Yes.
And if he didn't become this, how come this came into existence?
Right.
What for? Why? If the end has to be the same as the beginning, then what was the point? So, you know, it's a strange mystery. We speak of moksha and nirvana, but then why at all the atmas or the souls came into being? Birth in the original sense is self-limitation. All birth is a self-limitation. So birth is not, the physical birth itself is in a way a self-limitation, because the consciousness is born in a small body. And it's very difficult, you know, to adapt. In Savitri, one of the things that the mother says is the record of his daily experiences, Ashwapati's yoga. And then she says, the effort of the Divine Mother to adapt to earth nature. It's not easy. So why that consciousness chooses to inhabit itself in such a small, dark, dingy corner of the world, of creation? Of course, it is explained, one becoming the many, all that comes much later. But to start with, Shobindo allows that sense of mystery to remain. He allows us to reflect. We speak that death is a mystery. Death is a mystery that comes later. Birth is a greater mystery. Because if we solve the mystery of birth, we will automatically solve the mystery of death.
Exactly.
Why the one being chose to limit itself? Now if we know that reason, then death gets solved automatically.
Yes.
As long as we are limited, death will be there. You mate any part with infinity, death goes away. It gets solved. But birth is the original mystery. And the greatest of great mystery is the birth of God in time.
Yes.
So the insoluble mystery of birth.
And it's often the argument in many religions that if God is all light and all powerful, then what is this creation?
Yes. So the very simple answer, you know, the beauty of life is that, as I keep saying, Veda is everywhere. So, you see, when we look at a tree and how it propagates itself, we observe the same process of creation. So we have this giant tree in Oroville, for instance, the big banyan tree, and all the trees. Now, you know, they concentrate all their power and energy in a small little seed. Then that seed drops into the ground. That seed must get buried inside the ground, in the darkness. This is a tree which is free, it's breathing fresh air and sun and light, and yet it lets its seed drop into the darkness. Why? Because the possibility is there in that seed to become yet another tree and yet another tree and multiple trees in creation. So the reason why the Supreme Light chose, as the Vedas say, ekoham bahushyami, Shubhendu speaks of that in several places, the one becoming many. Many means what? Not just many as we are today, that would be absurd, but one divine becoming many, many, many multiple divines. There's a very nice little, you know, bhajan line I remember in Bengali. I'll translate it in English. But the line goes like this. Amar eke Krishna mon bhare na, ami anant Krishna dube chahi. I am not satisfied with one Krishna. I want infinite Krishna to play with. So, you see, this possibility is there that there can be infinite divinities upon earth. Of course, it's not easy. How can such a challenging task be easy? But it is there as a possibility. Therefore, and because it's difficult, the process is long. Because it's not easy in that seed to manifest all the powers. That's why the struggle. How can strength develop without the struggle? Even avatars who come, they have to go through the process of struggle to bring out their full-blown divinity. I mean, we see that Sri Aurobindo experienced, you know, the great realization of the Gita. In fact, the mother has used the word supramental experience, which goes one step further. When? When he was in the jail. So, you know, this is the process of bringing out the fullness of that which is within us enclosed. Now, that's the process, because, you know, when we are confronted with the darkness, we bring out the best within us. It can either break us or it can reshape us. That's the beauty of crisis. And that's why you see these lines, as in a dark beginning of all things. I think this one line gives so much hope.
Yes.
Dark beginning of all things. When we look at a dark beginning, or let's say when we look at evil, because we have passed away from that stage, so it's evil to us because we are no more engaged with that state. But we can equally see it is good in the making. It's very strange, difficult to understand, but
yes.
All evil is a good in the passing or a good in the making. As in a dark beginning of all things. And when we look at our own life journey, you were saying so beautifully 50 years back. So, very often, I just feel tears of gratitude when I look back at my life 25 years back. I say, but for the mother's grace, would have been in the same stupidities this world.
Yes.
How she has nurtured, nourished, watered the aspiration with her love. And that gives hope. So Savitri is through and through a song of hope. If nothing else, it fills the being with hope.
Yes.
You You know, because people often believe that there are some specially marked souls who have come upon earth. Everybody, for everything, even today I was reading from Question and Answers of the Mother, where she asked that he who chooses the infinite has been chosen by the infinite. So who are these people who are specially chosen by the infinite? Mother says, everyone is chosen by the infinite. It's just that some will discover it fast and some will discover it slowly. Yeah. All of us are seeds of the infinite. Yes. You know, this is such a great truth. So how it starts, you see how aspiration starts in us. A mute, featureless semblance of the unknown, repeating forever the unconscious act. See, even when we turn to the divine, see, it applies at every level.
Yeah.
We repeat the unconscious act. Very often people wonder, you know, people go to samadhi and they just touch their forehead to the samadhi and, you know, they touch the flowers. And a lot of people have don't understand it and they say, oh, will you get the divine? This is just mechanically, you know, how what people do in many temples. It doesn't matter. That's how things start. It doesn't matter. It's an unconscious act. Maybe we don't know to start with,
yeah,
whether it's conscious or unconscious. I would do it. I mean, do it with all the joy of my heart. Mm-hmm. But maybe that many would do it with just a mechanical mind. But doesn't matter. Things may start like that, but we do not know where it's going to reach. So repeating forever the unconscious act.
Even when we fail to
look into our souls, still there are parts that grow towards the light.
Yes.
That's why, and you know, Mother used to say, one goes to samadhi every day. It's not like, you know, when I feel like I'll go, when I don't feel like that, one will become at the mercy of fancies. It doesn't matter. Many times we are not in that perfect state. Yet things will start mechanically, but look where they will go. We will continue to habitually in our nature repeat things which are vestiges of darkness prolonging into our journey of the light.
Yes.
Doesn't matter. So you see, these lines open so many layers of psychological meaning. And of course, physically we know that when we get up in the morning, it's true that first thing should be divine and gratitude. But for most of humanity, it is the unconscious act. Go to the bathroom, take, you know, start brushing the teeth unconsciously. So even when light comes, even when divine comes, the avatar comes, we again connect with him in our usual, habitual way. And still, all this is a beginning. It's not the end. We should not lose hope. And yet, at the beginning of creation, earth moving unconsciously in the space. Who would have fathomed, as Shurinda says in The Life Divine, if there was an eternal witness, he would have wondered, what is this earth spinning in space?
Yeah.
Cold, dry, empty space. What's God's plan? He would say, it's a theater. Is it? What play is going to happen? Wait, divine has written the script. Who are the actors? He is the actor. He will wear many masks and come.
And that wonderful statement of the Mother.
Yes.
Wait for the final
act. Wait for the final act. He is himself the actor and the act.
Yes.
He is himself the seer and the seen.
And the knower.
Knower and the known. The lover and the beloved.
Yes.
So he will come. It's that stage. So you see, this first canto sets the stage.
Yeah.
It's the backdrop of the epic. It reminds us at one level of the day and the night, which every day morning when we wake up, it's a message of hope. One more day to live. Who knows? This is the day when Savitri would come into our life and we will die to our old self and be reborn to the new. Who knows?
The dawn in us.
Satyavan did not know the dawn in us. He did not know that today he, forever the unconscious act, every day, for him it was like, that also is described here. It was a noon like every other noon. For nature, when she walks, she goes on trampling, she doesn't care. So Satyavan gets up in the morning and he believes, well, like any other day, I'll go pick up some fruits, some wood for fire and come back home.
Singing. Happy.
But he didn't know that the Divine Mother has chosen this day for a great change. So every day, if we can wake up with this thought,
yes,
that who knows, today is the day when Savitri would ensure that the grace of the Divine Mother would ensure, her love will ensure that we are going to die to our old self and a new being will be born in us. She's accompanying us throughout. She's watching over us. Look at the beauty of this. Other days, Savitri doesn't go with him.
No.
It's that day that she goes with him. You know that story that
yes.
When a man walks in darkness, he sees only one set of footprints?
Right.
I was carrying you.
Yes.
So again, you see, when she knows that my child will be in crisis, that time she carries us. At other times, she says, okay, you go. I am sure Satyavan must have been hurt many times, faced some dangers. After all, a forest. She doesn't accompany. She is there at home, tending after the husband, the parents. And then he comes back, she has prepared a meal, like, you know, our everyday life, but in crisis. So you see, it's a story of the Divine Mother's relation with creation. How she binds herself. Who is Satyavan? The soul of man caught up in ignorance.
Yes.
The only thing that is needed is, like Satyavan, if we can just open to her, descend upon earth with thy moon gold feet. And what does he say? All that I can give you is a thatched hut,
yeah,
and some sweet little nothings,
yeah,
not for your comfort. You are a
princess.
Raj Rajeshwari. But will you come? And she sees the love in his heart and says, yes. And when the divine says yes, the whole world, death, nothing can keep us apart.
Yes.
So this is the beauty of Savitri. This is the story of Savitri. So it appears and it goes on. So in the first canto, we see this backdrop where at one level, it's about the dawn when Satyavan has to die. But the beauty is, and Satyavan has to be resurrected. So though it ends with, this was the day when Satyavan must die. At another level, every dissolution which opens the doors to a new creation. And for us, it's a hope.
Yes.
So, and that's why he says, almost that day the epiphany was disclosed.
Of which? Our life.
Our life. So, you know, every day we read the Veda, that light wins over darkness. Where is the doubt over it?
Yes. Yes.
Every day we see it, witness God's glory. And you see that line of nature, we must read that, you know, how the whole process of yagna in nature. It's a wonderful line on page 4. Actually, you know, every line is so wonderful. I am not going through it that way because, you know, it's not possible. But look at this, you know, we talk about yagna and we perform a yagna by lighting an outer fire. And then we offer, that's how traditional yagyas are done, the ritualistic interpretation. But what is that inner yagna?
Yeah.
The fire of sacrifice. And when that is lit, how do we look at creation?
When she has lit it in us.
Yes, it is, obviously.
Yes.
Her grace. So on page 4, toward the end, we have, when she touches, the omniscient goddess leaned across the breaths. Actually, these four lines are right, they remind of the story of the Rig Veda where the bride of Brahman moves far away from him. So you see, the omniscient goddess leaned across the breaths that wrap the fated journeyings of the stars and saw the spaces ready for her feet.
Yes.
Once she half looked behind for her veiled son. She has chosen to veil that, otherwise she cannot work. Then, thoughtful, went to her immortal work. This is the whole story in the Rig Veda. And then when she comes and touches earth, see what happens. And scattered on sealed depths, her luminous smile kindled to fire the silence of the world. Now, you know, people ask, how do we initiate in this yoga? Her smile initiates. Looking at her picture, smiling picture, it's a wonder. It's enough.
It's enough.
The fire is lit.
Yes.
It's the smile of the divine.
Yes.
Looking upon us with such a benevolent gesture that I know what you are because
yes.
I have become you.
Yes.
All grew a consecration, oh, kindled to fire the silence of the world. So, you know, there was silence, and now it is kindled to light. And what happens then? All grew a consecration and a rite. It's not that, you know, this activity or that activity. You know, when we are in that state of aspiration, everything is wonderful. Everything is luminous.
Yes.
And that's what is described. Air was a vibrant link between earth and heaven. Air becomes the link. You know, these are all Vedic symbols. At several levels we can, you know, they are the maruts which carry our aspiration upward. That's how the Vedas describe. But look, every day also, we don't look at it, this air which I am releasing, which I am breathing, has come from the peaks and it's going up towards the sun. That's how, you know, when people, there is a rite, they pour water into the Ganges and pour it to the sun. So the whole thing is that, look, you know, a very crude interpretation would be, how does it go to the sun at all? It's meaningless. Well, this rite is an inner rite. It should become an inner rite. It is there anyways. But when we make an offering of it, the very breathing can become a yagna. That's how Shivinda puts it. Because it is a yagna. We don't know it. We are not conscious. This whole air, even if you see very physically, what happens? The hot air tends to rise up and the cold air comes down. So what is happening here? At most physical level, it's a yagna.
Yes.
It goes from below, goes up, and then it comes down. That's how the convection currents are formed.
Yes.
So even at the most physical level, the symbol works. And if we can participate in this yagna of creation consciously, then it is yoga. If our breathing can become yagna, if we have nothing to do, just breathing as an offering. So you see, air was a vibrant link between earth and heaven. Our very breath can become a vibrant link. The wide wind hymn of a great priestly wind. So what is the chanting going on? What music, what rhythm? See, this is the beauty, the music of the sea, the music of the winds that blow through the trees. How do we fix it in any particular meter? And it's the chanting. Arose and failed upon the altar hills. So where is the altar? It goes there and stops there. The high boughs prayed in a revealing sky. All the trees as if they are aspiring for light, and man lifts the burden of his fate. This is the irony. The trees at that moment are still reaching to the light, happy with gratitude. That whole night they have waited.
Yes.
In the evening they go through a state of sorrow because, you know, that light is gone. That's how the mother puts it. And when that light comes, they are aspiring. But man picks up a big stone, puts on his head, and he starts moving with the burden of responsibilities and everything else. But if you could offer everything.
Yes.
So here is the high bow. See, this is the Veda. Every day we see it.
Yes.
Here, where our half-lit ignorance skirts the gulfs on the dumb bosom of the ambiguous earth. Here, where one knows not even the step in front, and truth has her throne on the shadowy back of doubt. Look, the power of here.
Yeah.
Twice.
Yes.
There is an expression in the Vedas, eva, here. Here too.
I spoke with Amal about the word dumb.
Yes.
And it is always silent. Never in the colloquial sense.
Yes.
It is a silent bosom of earth.
Yes. And again he uses, here to the vision and prophetic gleam, lit into miracles, meaningless shapes. Our lives get meaning from this touch of light, from the divine, from the grace, from the love and light that Savitri embodies.
But often we are not ready.
That's why it comes and withdraws. And we reduce it to the common light of earthly day.
When the divine afflatus, spent, withdrew, unwanted, fading from the mortal's range. A sacred yearning lingered in its trace. The worship of a presence and a power too perfect to be held by death-bound hearts. The prescience of a marvelous birth to come.
So this is the process. And we see this, that what the divine wants us to do. You see, when Shivananda speaks of four great events in the history of earth, it's very interesting that the third one, he speaks about Krishna's exile from Vrindavan. And then he says that that led to the awakening of devotion in the human heart. Suddenly he has withdrawn. When he was there, he was being treated as, oh, he's mine, and you know, the usual. Yeah. But when he goes, then they realize what they have lost. We have the same experience with Mother and Shri.
We do.
And yet, it is a prescience. Something is going to happen. This will be
a marvelous birth to come.
And it's quite natural that what it leaves in the heart, worship of a presence and a power, lingered in its trace. As he goes, yes, then human beings realize, oh my God, what was here? What did we miss? Many times people say that. In fact, Ravindraji used to say when he was asked that, you know, you people were very fortunate when somebody asked Ravindraji. He said, no, you don't realize. When they were here, we just treated them like humans. Yes. Someone, of course, exalted.
Yeah.
But for you, you can directly come in touch with her. Because they realize suddenly, after the going behind the scenes, what they missed. Another sadhak, he was telling me that, you know, when mother was there, we were asking all sorts of silly and stupid things.
Yeah.
We could have asked for anything.
And would have been given.
So you see what happens with the majority, it is like that. But then, it's not that it is wasted. Human hearts are limited. But something it still leaves, because it touches matter, and therefore the sense of the sacred awakens. Worship of a presence and a power, and also a prescience that there is something beautiful that is going to happen. So this is it, and and parallel to this, now the symbol dawn. So who is the dawn? It is Savitri.
Yes.
And what is the darkness? The normal human life, bound by so many desires, says fluttering, many-hued desire that moves the human hearts. When they wake up to light, oh, today I have to achieve this, get this. This is the human heart. But Savitri knows she has something to do.
When I was staying with Temi before she left, she would talk often about Savitri. And she said, yes, the divine event is the dawn. But it's also the birth of Savitri.
Yes. In creation. Yes. Such a wonderful thing.
Yes.
And the victory, which is going to take place, the imminent victory. And look, you know, how our relation with the Divine Mother, what a wonderful, you know, it's the story of the Divine Mother. And of course, on page 7, it's a very touching truth about, you know, how human nature responds to the divine event, selling the divine messengers, you know, what it returns back, pain, cross, in payment for the crown, suffering. And as he says, when the divine goes away, he builds a church in his name.
Yeah.
Whereas what should be really done is to build a church and a temple inside, where his presence can dwell, because that's why he has come. And he withdraws so that the aspiration can be lit. It's also a strategy. It's a divine strategy. Because human hearts seldom aspire. Things are very easy. Imagine a state when divine is right next to you. So sometimes an excess of light, aspiration cannot be nurtured.
Yes.
So the divine steps just one step behind. On page 8, as one who, watching over men left blind, takes up the load of an unwitting race. So we are the unwitting race.
Yes.
We don't even know what Mother and Shobindu have done, what they have taken upon and continue to take upon them.
Yes.
We will never know. We will, you know, we only see that we are walking the path and things, only some moments of intervention we understand. But how much more they continue to take.
We could go over and over these same lines again for weeks and weeks.
Yes, we'll and just probably, you know, close with these last few lines. On page 10. Rather on page 9, it's very interesting. All came back to her. Earth and love and doom. You see, that is the beauty of the divine embodiment. She at once sees the embodiment of that love. But she also identifies with earth nature. That's why we see many prayers in prayers and meditation where she is identified with the earth nature. It is the earth consciousness for which the divine comes. Man is only one embodiment of the earth consciousness, and it's a privilege given to him to change, to be the catalyst. But before man is there, evolutionary story is going on. Several times she has come for earth. It is the earth that aspires, the dumb earth, that speaks and aspires in man.
Yes.
And that is the beauty of this story.
All came back to
the
her.
Ancient disputants. It's a struggle between love and doom. The labor of love that is pulling creation out of the dark abysses. And the doom which pulls it back again and again. So this is the struggle. And the Divine Mother takes now upon herself the mortal's load. So this was the line which I wanted to read. All the fierce questions of man's hours relived, the sacrifice of suffering and desire, earth offers to the immortal ecstasy. What else she can offer? She offers her suffering, she offers her desires. Sanctify them, bless them, transmute them. So the yajna of the earth began again beneath the eternal hand. The priest, normally the mind, which is itself ignorant. So the divine comes and says, I will be the priest. I will do this sacrifice. I'll become the earth. And that's why she says, he offers all the agony of the globe. Mother's prayer.
Yes.
That, you know, monstrous forces have swept down upon earth. And she offers her body in a holocaust. Awake she endured the moment's serried march and looked on this green, smiling, dangerous world and heard the ignorant cry of living things. Amid the trivial sounds, the unchanging scene. Look at what an expression. We know that things are ever changing, but are they changing inside? They are the same. Unchanging scene, her soul arose confronting time and fate. Immobile in herself, she gathered force. This was the day when Satyavan must die.